to address the current shortage of healthcare professionals in our country and to help us achieve our goal of universal healthcare. We are greatly expanding our medical and nursing education programs. We will push the envelope even further. We are helping nursing graduates hurdle their board exams so that they will obtain their licenses and join our pool of healthcare professionals. Ang kalusugan ang ikalawang armas para sa lakas ng pangangatawan ng bawat Pilipino. Isinusulong natin muli ang kalusugan ng Pilipino. We are now refocusing our health priorities, applying the lessons learned from the pandemic and addressing the weaknesses that it has exposed. Healthier communities and lifestyles are our advocacy. We have launched convergent programs to address hunger and nutrition-related issues amongst our people, especially the children, like stunting and wasting. Last week, we introduced the pilot food stamp program, which seeks to supply the nutrition needs of the million most food poor Filipinos. The FSP, shall complement our nutrition continuity programs, such as the first 1,000 days program, which ensures nourishment for the first 3 years of a child's life. The supplemental feeding program is for our children attending daycare centers. The K-6 program will feed kindergarten to grade 6 public school students who are suffering from wasting and severe malnutrition. We are catching up on the routine vaccinations of our children. As of this year, more than 80% of our eligible children have been vaccinated against measles, rubella, and polio. Nananawagan ako sa lahat ng mga magulang na kumpletuhin ang mga bakuna ng kanilang mga anak at magtungo sa pinakamalapit na health center para sa mga libreng bakuna. The whole of society must exert efforts to suppress the alarming rise of tuberculosis and HIV/AIDS. To stem the tide, the strategic plan is to ensure early diagnosis and treatment and ample testing sites and medications. Our healthcare system is undergoing structural changes. Public health facilities are being increased, both in number and in capability. Last year, more than 3,400 projects were completed to improve capacity for specialized medical treatment. Specialty centers in various fields are being established and integrated into our government hospitals. In the last year, additional 60 specialty centers have been opened to the public. Just last week, we inspected the site of what will soon be a 5-hectare multi-specialty center in Pampanga, which will specialize in pediatrics, cardiology, kidney, and cancer treatment. We are working for a more direct, efficient delivery of services through integrated primary care providers and networks in partnerships with the LGUs and our partners in the private sector. These shall, of course, be supported by what is now a better and more efficient PhilHealth. Ang presyo ng mga mahalaga at pangunahing gamot ay bumaba ng humigit kumulang ng 40%. Mayroon ding iba na bumaba na hanggang 90%. Aside from the maximum retail price regulation being implemented, strategic VAT exemptions also lowered the prices of 59 essential medications, such as those for cancer, diabetes, hypertension, kidney disease, and mental illness. Palapit ng palapit na tayo. Palapit na tayo sa hangarin na ang lahat ng Pilipino ay makakakuha ng serbisyong pangkalusugan. Sa ngayon, mahigit 93% na ang kasapi sa PhilHealth. Sa pinagandang konsulta package ng PhilHealth, 21 klase ng mga gamot at 13 laboratory service ang ibibigay ng libre. Ngayon, meron na tayong mahigit 2,000 konsulta center sa buong bansa. Ang bilang na ito ay mas marami ng 35% mula nung nakalipas na taon. upang mas lalo pang makatulong sa mga pasyente, ang dating 90 libreng dialysis session ay inakyat na natin sa 156. Mga kababayan, libre na po ngayon ang dialysis para sa karamihan ng Pilipino. Noong nakalipas na taon, mahigit 3.4 million na Pilipino ang nabigyan ng tulong sa ilalim ng Medical Assistance for Indigent Patients program ng DOH. Tinutugunan natin ngayon ang ating kakulangan sa mga doktor at mga nurse sa pamamagitan ng mga reforma sa edukasyon, patuloy na pagsasanay at paniniguro sa kanilang kapakanan. Naglagay po tayo ng doktor sa halos 200 munisipyo sa bansa. Lalagyan natin din ang doktor ang natitirang 19 na bayan na wala pang doktor. Upang masuklian naman natin ang naging sakripisyo ng ating mga health workers sa pribado at pampubliko ng mga ospital nung nakaraang pandemya, ipapamahagi na sa kanila ang kanilang COVID health emergency allowance at iba pang mga nabimbing benepisyo. Kasabay ng pangangalaga natin sa edukasyon at kalusugan ng ating mamamayan, tinitiyak din natin na may sapat at magandang hanap buhay sa loob at maging sa labas ng bansa. As of May this year, our employment rate rose to 95.7%, clear proof of the improvement from the severe unemployment that we experienced during the height of the pandemic. Employment then was at a low of 82.4%. But even with our current high level of employment, we must do more. We will generate additional jobs for the remaining 4.3% of our workforce, as well as for the 11.7% underemployed Filipinos seeking better employment opportunities. Under the banner of our fast-growing economy, we are aggressive in our investment and business promotions and facilitations. For that, we have not limited ourselves to the local economy, but we have looked to the global economy for partnerships and agreements. Our independent foreign policy, a friend to all and enemy of none, has proven effective. We have formed strategic alliances with our traditional and newfound partners in the international community. We have embarked on foreign trips to promote the interests of the country for peace building and for mutually beneficial purposes. These economic missions have yielded an estimated total investment value of 3.9 trillion pesos or $71 billion, with a potential to generate 175,000 jobs. The implementation of recent economic reforms is underway. BOI-approved investment projects have reached 1.2 trillion pesos during our first year, while other strategic investments approved for processing through the newly established green lanes amount now to 230 billion pesos. Our existing bilateral and multilateral trade agreements, notably within the ASEAN framework, and with Japan and with Europe, and allow us to leverage our competitive advantages and reap economic benefits. We will continue to forge more of these international partnerships that will lead to a more balanced trade strategy and a healthier economic position. The Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, or RCEP, is now in force. It is a multilateral trade arrangement with the ASEAN and other countries such as Australia, China, Japan, Korea, and New Zealand. We can now have competitive access to a regional market that comprises 2 billion people. As we address our weaknesses and develop competitiveness in other potential areas, we must also play to our strengths. Our competitive advantage must be leveraged. As a service export powerhouse, we must continue to nurture the growth of the services sector, particularly the information technology business process management sector, and of course, the tourism industry. Our tourism has always been a reliable pillar of our economic growth through the years, providing livelihood to more than 5 million of our citizens. Because of the reopening of the economy and the phenomenon of revenge travel, this sector is headed for a great rebound. From January to June this year, we have received 3 million international visitors. This number is already 62% of our 4.8 million target for the entire year. Mga kababayan, ang lahat ng mga ginagawa natin ito ay magbibigay bunga sa libu-libong hanap buhay para sa ating mga kababayan. To create these investment opportunities, we must ensure that an enabling business environment is in place, that there is peace and order, and that the rule of law governs. We will solidify our country's reputation as an attractive and reliable investment destination. Building on institutional reforms of recent years, we have created green lanes for strategic investments and expedited the business processes in various sectors and investment modalities. A progressive and rationalized system of taxation is a component of the ease of doing business. The CREATE law has made our corporate tax and incentive schemes equitable and business-friendly. There are more structural tax reforms that must be introduced to allow us to reach our socio-economic targets. Digitalization is the call of today, not the call of the future, not the call of the future, but of the present. It is here, it is needed, and it is needed today. Government must fully embrace digitalization to provide better service to the people through its vital frontline services and its back-end functions. Digitalization will support the government's data-driven and science-based planning and decision-making. It is the greatest, most powerful tool, not just to improve the ease of doing business, but also against many forms of graft and corruption. Data shows that digitalization in conjunction with government streamlining efforts has significantly boosted efficiency. Notable examples are in the areas of government payments, company and business registrations, issuance of permits and licenses, loan applications, and revenue collection. All our digitalization efforts will be linked to our payment systems, whose digital transformation has been accelerating at a remarkable rate. Digital payments accounted for 42% of the total retail payments made in 2022, whether by businesses or individuals or by the government. Its high trajectory is now well positioned to achieve Banco Central's target of 50% of total retail payments by this year. The EGOPH app has also been launched. As envisioned, all key government services are to be integrated into the single and centralized mobile app for the convenience of the general public. The national ID system will be at the core of this digitally transformed network of government services. It will fundamentally change the lives of each Filipino. At 87% total registration, we are now closer to establishing a complete, accurate, and reliable digital database of our own for the entire population. This has already been integrated into the eGovPH app and can be now accessed by our citizens. Consistent with this transformative policy direction, all government offices must then ensure that their vital services are digitalized immediately. In response to this call, the Department of Migrant Workers launched last week the Department of Migrant Workers Mobile to make the journey of our overseas Filipino workers easier. Because of system upgrades, our internet speed has improved. As of June of this year, our fixed broadband speed ranks 47th amongst 180 countries. This ranking is 11 places higher than it was last year. Our mobile internet speed is now ranked at 83 out of 142 countries, which is 8 places higher than it was last year. There will be more improvements as our internet infrastructure undergoes further upgrades. Earlier this year, Starlink went live in the Philippines, now providing high-speed satellite broadband connectivity. Our national fiber backbone and broadband ng masa projects will also deliver high connectivity and high-speed internet. We are prioritizing geographically isolated and disadvantaged areas. The DICT has been directed to consolidate all these digitalized government services into the eGovPH app, to establish the National Government Portal and the Philippine Business Data Bank to improve the internet speed in our country. With our e-commerce roadmap firmly in place, we are poised to take this digitalization drive further and beyond, utilizing e-commerce to take full advantage of new technologies. The first bill that I signed into law was the SIM Registration Act, because we are mindful of the risks and vulnerabilities that can lead to negative consequences. Digital users and consumers shall be protected from identity theft, phishing, other online scams, through essential systems and safeguards, such as cybersecurity, data privacy, consumer complaint mechanisms, and financial literacy campaigns. The training is necessary to ease the transition of those whose jobs would be affected by the shift to digitalization are also now being included in the curricula and programs offered by TESDA, DICT, and other agencies of government. It is our wish that one day, foreign employment will be driven by choice, not by necessity. It remains a noble calling that our OFWs have answered, requiring great sacrifice from them, their families, and their communities. We are engaging with our partners in the international community to ensure a safe working environment for our countrymen. And as we do so, we are also putting in place responsive mechanisms for the social welfare, repatriation, and reintegration of our returning OFWs into the Philippine economy. As the world economy reopens, we are witnessing a rise in overseas Filipino deployment. In 2022, the number has increased by 62%. OFWs continue to send in historically high remittances, solidifying their role in our transformative economic growth. In 2022, our OFWs contributed $32.5 billion, or roughly 1.8 trillion pesos, to our economy. Several countries have also signified interest to explore bilateral labor cooperation with the Philippines in the areas of healthcare, tourism, hospitality, engineering, construction, and information technology. Recently, we signed agreements with Singapore, Austria, and the province of Alberta in Canada. Our priority is to ensure that the principles of ethical recruitment, fair employment, and the safe and orderly migration of our people are embodied in our agreements with other countries. For example, the deployment issue in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia has now been resolved. And as of today, 70,000 of our OFWs have already been deployed to Saudi Arabia for employment. Moreover, the unpaid salaries and other related claims of some 14,000 OFWs who have been put out of work in Saudi Arabia during the pandemic are now being processed. The Crown Prince of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia himself personally committed to me that the unpaid claims of Filipino workers would now be paid. The continued employment of some 50,000 workers and the deployment of many more Filipino seafarers aboard EU vessels has also been assured. The lesson for us is that our education and skills training must always be attuned to the high, exacting, and constantly evolving global standards. Sa pagsusumikap ng mga mamamayan, walang hindi kakayanin. Kahit ang mga matatayog na pangarap ay maaabot, kasama ang inaasam na tahanan. Katuwang natin ang lokal na pamahalaan at pribadong sektor upang matulungan ang Pilipino sa pangangailangan ng pabahay. Patuloy ang serbisyo ng Pag-ibig Fund upang makatulong sa kanyang 15 milyong membro para makabili ng bahay. Sa nakaraang taon, mahigit 100,000 ang kumuha ng housing loan sa Pag-ibig na nagkakahalaga ng 117 bilyon na piso. Ito ang pinakamataas ng bilang sa buong kasaysayan ng Pag-ibig. Itong nakalipas na taon, mahigit 148,000 na kabahayan at mahigit 30,000 mga Certificate of Eligibility of Lot Award ang naipamahagi sa Luzon, sa Visayas at sa Mindanao sa ilalim ng sari-saring mga programang pabahay ng pamahalaan. Mahigit 35,000 residential free patent at agricultural patent titles naman ang naibigay sa mga benepisyaryo nito sa buong bansa. Hindi pa dito natatapos. Papalawigin pa natin ang ating programa sa abot-kayang pabahay, lalo na para sa mga mahihirap nating kababayan. Itong nakalipas na taon, inilunsad natin ang pambansang pabahay para sa Filipino Housing Program o 4PH. Nagkaroon na tayo ng groundbreaking sa 25 lugar sa iba't ibang bahagi ng bansa. Nagpirmahan na rin ang ng kasunduan upang simulan ang mga proyekto sa mahigit 100 lokasyon. Kung susumahin natin ito, mahigit 1,000,000 kabahayan ang maialay natin sa ating mga kababayan sa buong bansa. The building blocks of progressive, livable, and sustainable communities will never be complete without appropriate and responsible action to mitigate and to adapt to the effects of climate change. We can never lose sight of our responsibility to the future. The economic agenda cannot and will not ever be incompatible with our climate change agenda. Climate change is now an important criterion in our integral national policies, in planning, decision-making, up to the implementation of programs. The potential advantages of such enlightened policies extend to jobs and livelihood, with the unlocking of the development of the green and blue economies. We have learned many painful lessons from past disasters, but we continue to be alert and prepared in our disaster response. It has in fact been commented that sometimes we are over-prepared for such natural disasters. Well, to continue that, we are reorganizing our response teams to make them more adaptable, agile, and effective in times of calamities and crises, with a clear unity of command. Our evacuation centers are being upgraded to withstand the greater forces of the new normal of extreme weather, as well as other natural and man-made disasters. Furthermore, new evacuation centers are also being built, of which 55 have already been completed. We remain committed to global decarbonization goals and the reduction of our carbon footprint. We preserve and protect the treasure that is our forests. Their value to the environment, to the ecology, and the economy is incalculable. We have adopted the concept of the circular economy, using nature as our model. The aim is to keep raw materials in a closed loop. In our world with scarce resources, the circular economy allows us to fully use these resources, minimize waste, and reduce the need for new resources, just as it is in nature. Just like our climate change action, this new system requires the participation of all sectors of society, up to each individual citizen, for it to succeed. Only a whole-of-government and whole-of-society approach will enable us to do all of these. It is necessary to apply all the resources that are at hand if we are to progress as quickly as we need to. Collaboration is the key between and among government offices, and between government and the private sector, between industries and the academic, between government and international partners, and most importantly, collaboration between and among our populace. Kakailanganin natin ang tulong at kakayahan ng buong pamahalaan at ng buong bansa. And so, we shall do the same for the next 5 years. We seek not only to become more effective, but more, to become truly transformative. This approach will be operationalized through the interagency cooperations, as well as through coordinated efforts between and among the three branches of government and the independent constitutional bodies. We have organized private sector advisory councils and national local mechanisms to establish the needed linkages. Once again, on this same principle, I urge the government to enact a new government procurement law and a new government auditing code. This to make government procurement and auditing more attuned to these changing times. We will give effect to the mandate of the Constitution and the Local Government Code as clarified by the Supreme Court very soon. Almost all the required devolution transition plans of the LGUs are done. To fully prepare them for optimal devolution, the necessary technical and financial assistance is being extended to our local governments. In everything that we do, the enduring Filipino quality of Bayanihan will still be our guide. Limang taon mula nung matinding kaguluhan, babango na ang Marawi City. Nanunumbalik na ang sigla sa pamayanan, maraming proyekto ang nakumpleto at mga infrastrukturang na itatayo. Kasalukuyan na tayo nagpoproseso ng tulong pananasyal para sa mga biktima ng Marawi Siege upang sila ay makapagsimula muli. Naway mamayani ang pag-asa, naway magpatuloy ang pagkakaisa, pagmamatyag at paghahangad ng kapayapaan at kaunlaran. We are proud of the progress that the BARM has taken. It will be self-governing. It will be self-governing, it will be progressive, and it will be effective. But this was only made possible because of the cooperation of all key groups. We talked to the local governments, the royal families, the MNLF, the IMLF, MILF, were all consulted and represented in this transition phase. The international community has also supported us in this smooth transition. Former adversaries are now partners in peace. Its functions have been defined, and its basic laws are now being written. Through the BARM, we have strengthened the nation's prospects for finally achieving sustainable progress anchored on a true and lasting peace in southern Philippines. We will continue to support the progress of the BARM, apace with our singular vision for all Filipinos. A strong and stable rule of law will strengthen the foundation of our transformation. Our police and armed forces are being strengthened and modernized to be more effective in maintaining peace and order and in defending our sovereignty. We fully support the judiciary's efforts to improve the justice system and to protect constitutional rights. The campaign against illegal drugs continues, but it has taken on a new face. It is now geared towards community-based treatment, rehabilitation, education, and reintegration to curb drug dependence amongst our affected citizenry. Last year, we launched the Buhay Ingatan Drogay Ayawan, or BIDA, program and established an additional 102 Balay Silangan Reformation Centers nationwide. We will relentlessly continue our fight against drug syndicates, shutting down their illegal activities, we will shut down their activities and dismantle their network of operations. Unscrupulous law enforcers and others involved in the highly nefarious drug trade have been exposed. I will be accepting their resignations. In their stead, we will install individuals with unquestionable integrity who will be effective and trustworthy in handling the task of eliminating this dreaded and corrosive social curse. We cannot tolerate corruption or incompetence in government. For almost half a century, some of our fellow Filipinos have taken to arms to make their views known and felt. We are now at a point in our history when their armed struggle has evolved. We have now progressed together towards peace and development. We have incorporated capacity building and social protection into our reintegration programs to guarantee full decommissioning of former combatants. Through community development and livelihood programs, the barangay development and enhanced comprehensive local integration programs have been effective in addressing the root cause of conflict in the countryside. To complete this reintegration process, I will issue a proclamation granting amnesty to rebel returnees, and I ask Congress to support me in this endeavor. Our journey to progress requires imperative that our nation remains intact and inviolable, our sovereignty preserved. We will protect our sovereign rights and preserve our territorial integrity in defense of a rules-based international order. With our national interest paramount, we will always pursue constant dialogue and diplomatic approaches to the resolution of any issue that may arise. So the initial results of our efforts inspire confidence. Let us continue to be relentless in our aspiration of peace and progress. This has not been the work of a single person, neither a single branch of government, nor even the whole government acting alone. This is the collective synergy achieved by all Filipinos working together. It took a whole-of-nation effort to achieve this immediate recovery from our pandemic slump. Unity was what made us rise once more. Nagsisimula pa lamang tayo. Ang pagbangon ng ating bayan ay magpapatuloy pa. Hinihiling ko ang inyong tiwala at pakikiisa. Sa ganitong paraan, makakamtan natin ang ating tanging hangarin, ang maginhawa, matatag at panatag na buhay para sa lahat ng Pilipino. Makikipagtulungan tayo ng mabuti sa Kongreso para sa mga mahalagang batas na kinakailangan para sa ating tuloy-tuloy na pag-ahon. And once again, I appeal to Congress for its support for the following priority legislations. The essential tax measures under our medium-term fiscal framework, such as excise tax on single-use plastics, VAT on digital services, rationalization of mining fiscal regime, motor vehicle users charge, road users tax, the military and uniform personnel pension, amendment of the Fisheries Code, amendment of the Anti-Agricultural Smuggling Act, amendment of the Cooperative Code, new government procurement law, new government auditing code, anti-financial account scamming, Tatak Pinoy law, the blue economy law, ease of paying taxes, LGU income classification, and the Philippine Immigration Act. In the past year, it has been a source of great hope and optimism to me to now know that there is an enormous pool of highly competent and dedicated workers serving in our government. It is up to us to provide good leadership and guidance. They love the Philippines and have responded to our call. I have stated before that my confidence in our future was grounded in our world-class quality workforce. Be they the farmers in the field, corporate giants, government officials, school teachers, health workers, or employees. That confidence has been further buoyed by the demonstration of love for the Philippines. Every Filipino has unanimously risen to the challenge that we have made to them to be part of our nation's future. Handa silang maghandog ng tulong dahil mahal nila ang kanilang kapwa Pilipino at mahal na mahal nila ang Pilipinas. And thus, with this in my heart, I know that the state of the nation is sound and is improving. Dumating na po ang bagong Pilipinas. Maraming salamat po sa inyo. Yes.